In 1995, members of the Matsaika Canoe Club assembled at Little Mossoro Bay. Our intention was to cross Banks Strait and visit the Furmeaux Islands.
You're already late.
Where did you come from this morning?
Why is that? Change your plan. We're going to leave at 7:30. You just forgot to tell me that.
Yeah.
You weren't there last night, to bloody tell you.
Grant Highland and I were paddling the double. We'd had to pack very carefully to get everything in.
You guys ready yet?
The Reverend Brownrigg sailed to the Furmeaux Islands in the 1870s. He described his journeys in his book, Mission to the Islands. 120 years later, we wanted to follow in his footsteps. The 36-kilometre crossing of Banks Strait can be one of the most challenging trips around the Tasmanian coast. Timing of the crossing is very crucial. Strong tidal currents of up to 5 knots in relatively shallow water can lead to difficult seas. A miscalculation can push a sea canoeist into the dangerous tidal rips around the coast. It wasn't long before we were opposite Swan Island. In the distance we could see the Swan Island Lighthouse, a favourite destination for the club's annual general meetings. As we paddled out into the strait, our thoughts went back to the near disaster of inexperienced sea canoeists who tried to cross some years ago. Although very experienced river paddlers, they didn't consider the tides, had unseaworthy kayaks, and lacked local knowledge of conditions. They very nearly drowned when caught near Moriarty Point, kayaks full of water and being swept out into the Tasman Sea. In the 1998 trip to the islands, Laurie and I were joined by John Heineman and Rex Brown of Victoria. The conditions we experienced were challenging to say the least.
Back to Victoria, she's all off.
Got your sail up yet? We'll have to take a rain check on this one, won't we?
I'll lose it. No laughing, you guys.
Should be a good trip over the Swan, I think.
Yeah, might be a bit on our left.
Should be a quick trip anyway.
Rex appeared to have a little problem crossing the barway at the river mouth in his heavily laden kayak. Conditions were gusting to 40 knots, with a strong outgoing tide taking us very quickly to Swan Island. While surfing down waves, the video camera dangled in the water. I was going so fast at times that the water pressure forced open one of the catches on the housing. It took only a small amount of water to ruin the lens, and that was the end of the video record for that trip. Back on the 1995 trip, we were now in mid-strait. The northeasterly had freshened and we were making good progress under sail. The best way to cross the strait is to allow 3 hours of outgoing tide to take you towards Moriarty Point, and then use 3 hours of incoming tide to sweep you up the coast of Clark Island to our first camping spot on Preservation Island.
Roadhog!
It was about here that we suddenly saw a gleaming white luxury cruise liner negotiating the strait. It was some distance behind us, and I doubt if they could see us. After about 5 hours, we were approaching the historic Rum and Preservation Islands, site of the wreck of the Sydney Cove. It was this event that led Bass and Flinders to start their famous journey to prove the existence of Bass Strait. The captain and crew of the Sydney Cove swam ashore on this island in 1797. They stayed on the island until rescued. Today, it is owned by a consortium of Launceston people. Laurie had arrived early and watched our approach from a vantage point. Mick was the last to arrive at Preservation. We hadn't lost sight of him, but he often likes to explore every little nook and cranny along the coastline. The owners of the island left the well-equipped shack unlocked, and provided everyone respected their property, didn't mind visitors using the facilities. It would certainly make a comfortable start to our trip. After changing into dry clothes, I climbed the granite boulders behind the shack to get a panoramic view over Armstrong Channel and Clark Island. This is Rum Island, so named because Captain Hamilton of the Sydney Cove kept the ship's cargo of rum here for safekeeping from the crew.
The red light blocks, isn't it?
Must stick something over that.
So that I don't know.
Later that evening, I climb the rocks once again for a peaceful end to the first day. Next day started out with northerly squalls, which temporarily eased as we got ready to leave for Badger Island. This was to be a relatively short paddle of about 20 kilometres. So we could afford to dawdle along the coast of Cape Barron Island. We didn't leave until the tide changed, so that we would be carried up along the coast and around Cape Sir John. Many journeys by sea kayak in this area are best dictated by tides, as currents are strong.
I thought it was fully low tide at 11, I thought that's what you were saying.
No, earlier.
10:30. The tide change is probably about 9:15.
The coast is quite scenic here, even on an overcast day. Rounded, lichen-covered granite boulders are interspersed with hidden sandy coves and sheltered campsites. With tidal assistance, we were soon rounding Cape Sir John, bringing the sawtooth Strzelecki Ranges on Flinders Island into view. Sailing up the passage next to Long Island, we were heading for the township of Cape Barron Island, hoping to get one of the notorious Barron Burgers.
A Barron Burger, of course.
Have you had one last time we were in?
No, it's only you and Kay walked the shop, I think, isn't it?
We talk about it a lot.
Didn't you go and get one when you went to get the pizza?
I thought we all went to the shop that
night.
No. Some time earlier, Laurie had disappeared around the point in a rain squall, while we had landed to change the video batteries. On a wet Sunday morning, no one seemed to be around as we pulled into the small cove and walked to the island's only shop. Unfortunately, the shop was closed and we were obliged to eat sea kayaking rations. We had half expected to meet up with Laurie, but there was no sign of him anywhere. As the trip leader, I wasn't particularly concerned. The weather wasn't bad, and we all knew that Badger Island was today's destination.
Excuse me.
Leaving Cape Barron Island behind, we rounded Long Island in squally conditions. A short time later, a rudder cable snapped in the double. We landed on Long Island to complete some temporary repairs so that we could enjoy a downwind sail to Banjer Island. Freshening northeasterly winds and rain squalls made for a fast crossing to Badger Island. Laurie had been on Badger Island for nearly 4 hours before he could make out the double sails driving through the rain.
Yeah.
We found out that Laurie had set his course straight for Badger Island, losing sight of us in the frequent rain squalls near Cape Sir John. Laurie had had to move his tent fly to a more sheltered site after wind gusts tore it in half. He rarely carries a tent, so he also had to make some temporary repairs. Around the campfire, Mick enjoyed the last of his sausages for the trip. This is a relative luxury for him, as his wife Lisa doesn't allow such food at home.
Call that food, do you?
Our campsite on Badger Island is historically quite interesting. In 1872, the Reverend Brownrigg described the settlement here as consisting of comfortable homesteads, built of wood, closely thatched with grass, and verandas with elegant creepers. They have small, neat gardens stocked with a variety of flowers, including geraniums and fuchsias. He conducted many church services in the home of Lucy Beeden, a second-generation islander. She was instrumental in getting the Tasmanian government to establish a school on the island in the 1870s. There are still many signs of this early island settlement. In an era of progress and expansion, it is somewhat eerie to camp in the quiet shadows of a once thriving community. We stayed up late, recounting tales of former trips and experiences. I can understand why Lucy Beeden chose Badger Island as her home. The mornings bring magnificent sunrises with the mountains of Cape Barron and Flinders Islands as backdrops. I strolled along an old cart track to the old jetty and wool store out near the point. The jetty and shed are still in use by Alf Stackhouse, the island's lessee. With strong and blustery westerlies, it didn't look too promising for our journey out to Goose Island, which is due west from where we are now. We could see the Goose Island lighthouse from a small rise near Alf Stackhouse's shack, but it would be next to impossible to get there today. Identified our plans and decided to head east, with the wind, past Chapel Island and over to Trousers Point. In the meantime, Mick and I did a bit of exploring around Alf's homestead. There was another heritage monument to the early islanders on this side of the island. Nearby were the various farm buildings. We were amazed to find a Suzuki four-wheel drive in one of the sheds.
Go for a bomb back to the ship.
No bloody brakes.
Oh. Don't worry about that.
It was now mid-morning, so we decided to head back and get ready for what should be an interesting sail to Trousers Point. On the way, we saw some of Alf's buildings, the woolshed, his homestead, and the old stone walls built by the early pioneers. It was only about 10 kilometres from Badger Island to Trousers Point, but conditions were just ideal for sailing in sea kayaks.
Just go
Once out past the shelter of the island, we caught the full force of the westerly. Things happened fast, with the sea kayaks surfing down the face of nearly every wave. Things got quite hectic at times, with the sails jibing and the kayaks often underwater. It was one of the most exhilarating sessions on the whole trip. The group found it difficult to keep together, particularly when the double suddenly broached at the bottom of a large wave. "The rudder's broken," screamed Grant, as we lay broadside to the swells. We gingerly got up to speed again and managed to steer with stern rudders as the wind pushed us ever closer to Trousers Point. Laurie was off to the south somewhere, but Mick stayed close so that we could get some excellent shots of him surfing down the waves. Or was it in case of a capsize? We were now pretty close to Trousers Point. It seemed as though we'd had covered the 10 kilometres in only a few minutes.
that was an exhilarating ride.
We eagerly swapped experiences of our crossing. It had all been over too quickly.
What happened to you? What was yours?
Sail fell apart. First of all, that the end sail tube fell out. And then I pulled this out, so I was sure I was going to lose that any minute. And then just after I left you guys, you know, I was trying to go around and then I jived. You know, I couldn't get the sail. It was just flogging like crazy, you know, and then the boom popped out the end.
What a bloody great ride in!
Show us your white sail.
Apart from one down the back of your neck.
This is the worst casualty of the whole trip.
Oh, I got water. Water is cooling.
Oh, dearie me. Sandwiches?
Are they wet or dry?
Yeah. Wet.
We had trouble fixing it so that it's usable,
though. No, not for now. I'll just sew a thing around there. Collar around there.
Oh, okay.
A bit of a stitch in there, right. She'll be all right. No,
it's not supposed to flex at 360 degrees, is it?
See the problem? Yeah, when I first saw it, the blade was out on the water at that level.
I walked around the point to look back at Mount Chapel Island and the conditions we had weathered. It's curious how the seas never look quite as big from the security of dry land.
It's good to see you.
On returning, everyone was busy repairing sails, tent flies, or other bits of strained gear.
Looks very professional.
You wait till it's finished. You'll eat your words.
Fortunately, a passing tourist offered Grant a lift back to White Mark to get the stainless steel rudder welded.
See ya. Other bit.
Yes.
See,
bit lumpy in there.
At the end of the third day of our trip, we were wondering what other excitement the Furmeaux Islands were going to offer us. Well, what would day four have in store for us? We were heading for another interesting place. Vansittart, or Gun Carriage Island, on the eastern side of the Furmeaux Islands.
You better keep up with him, Jeff. You take mine.
Have you got something?
Yes, could I have my paddle, please, Jeffrey?
With the still strong westerlies, it would mean more sailing. Oh, what a pity. I really wanted to do more paddling.
That starts the sequence, does it? The sailing sequence.
I hope so.
We would follow the southern shore of Flinders Island, down Franklin Sound to Lady Barron. I was determined to make up for that missed hamburger at Cape Barron Island.
Drop the book up on the deck and read it.
As we pulled away from the shelter of Trousers Point, we gradually increased speed until we were once again on an adrenaline rush, surfing down the waves. We stopped a few times so that we could get better video shots. Mick went screaming past and then capsized for no apparent reason.
Who's capsized? No.
We could have come alongside straight away, but Mick preferred to have a go at getting back in, unaided. This is no mean feat in an unstable North Sea tourer with the sail still up. Well, eventually he conceded defeat and we quickly pulled alongside. It wasn't long before we were all off again, surfing down the endless procession of waves. These are the joys of sea canoeing. Sometime later, lorry veered off to the right and headed for Vansittart. We kept course for Lady Byrne and the good food. Lady Byrne is the main shipping port for Flinders Island. The club frequently stops here to top up on supplies on long trips. The small township of Lady Byrne has a good motel hotel that serves delicious fresh seafood counter meals. We were suitably attired this time and we were allowed in to enjoy the comforts of civilization. Poor lorry, roughing it out in the wind and rain on Vansittart Island. After a quick digestive nap in the shade, we were off back into the unrelenting winds. Passing Green and Great Dog Island brought us to the point where we had to brave the winds and currents again. Mick was the first to put up his sail and scoot off. We followed shortly, but then had to pull down our shredded sail after only a few minutes. In the distance, we could see Mick tearing over the waves, but then he suddenly disappeared from view. When we caught up to him, he was sitting on his kayak. Apparently there's one and only one slightly submerged rock near where we were going, and yes, Mick had found it. Lorry had also been watching this hilarious incident from the rocks nearby. Good old Mick, ever the adventurous one. Mick shared the tale of his adventure. Surfing down the waves, he had suddenly been horrified to see the water drop away, revealing a huge rock. Too late to stop, he had hit it and glanced off, capsizing him yet again. Rather than sit around in the miserable conditions, we explored the remnants of former occupants of the island. It was once home to many sealers and escaped convicts. This stone chimney and fireplace were once part of the home of Captain Alexander Ross. He came to these islands to salvage the wreck of the Cambridgeshire in 1875. He decided to stay here and married Elizabeth Bates, who then owned the island. They ran 2,000 sheep here, had a shop and a post office, and were considered to be the kindliest of people. From a nearby hilltop, I watched a succession of squalls race down Franklin Sound. The afternoon sky gradually turned to gold as the sun fought the dark storm clouds. It was repair time again after tea. This time it was wetsuit booties to be repaired, and once again we sewed up the sails on the double.
Straps on the mast and the rest are gone.
The start of day five saw Grant and I on top of Gun Carriage Hill to see the sunrise. The view is magnificent, a 360-degree panorama. To the north lay Lady Barron and the Potboil. To the east we could see the wreck of the Farsund, one of our chief objectives for today. We would need to negotiate the shallow channel between Cape Barron and Vansittart Islands to get to the wreck. We had to punch hard into the choppy conditions around the point, but then conditions eased and we put up sails to drift out with the tide and wind. Today we would aim to get to Christmas Beach on the southeast corner of Cape Barron Island, but not before a visit to the wreck of the Farsund. The bark Farsund was wrecked in 1912. When 59 days out from Buenos Aires, she was blown onto the Vansittart Shoals by a northeasterly gale. A number of salvage attempts were made to get her off. She was in fact refloated, only to mysteriously drift aground again. We were lucky. The conditions were so calm that Mick clambered on board for some good photos. The wreck is a photographer's paradise. The rusty hull still retains the graceful lines of a clipper ship. Mick and I climbed up onto the deck. It is amazing just how much of the Farsund is intact. In the main cabin, slate tiles still cover the floor. I would certainly recommend that anyone sea kayaking around Flinders Island make the Farsund one of their objectives. We left the wreck in the late morning to sail down the eastern side of Cape Barron Island. Laurie was once again in front somewhere. He had been resting on Puncheon Point while we were on board the Farsund.
Yeah,
It was quite relaxing, sailing down the coast towards Harley's Point. We stopped nearby to have lunch. We didn't stay long, as we wanted to camp near Christmas Beach on the southeast corner of the island. Laurie was first away, putting up both his sails again. There were quite strong currents as we passed the light on Cape Barren. After rounding Cape Barren, we had a hard slog against the wind while crossing Jameson's Bay. The campsite at Christmas Beach is tucked in behind the Burbialas and completely sheltered. On the next day, we had some time for exploring, as we wanted to wait for the tide to change to help us through the Sea Lion Narrows with its 6-knot currents. I walked along Christmas Beach to get a view of the imposing Mount Kerford. When I returned, Grant had packed up and Laurie had climbed the rocky ridge behind the campsite for a view of Sea Lion Narrows. I still had time for a quick dip in the crystal clear waters before departing. We rounded Cone Point, staying close to the shore and exploring the unusual rock formations. Approaching Petticoat Bay, we noticed some fishing boats at anchor and headed over for a chat and the latest weather information. The skipper of the Even Steven offered us the use of his radio phone to contact our families. Mick took up his kind offer and clambered aboard to ring Lisa.
Yeah.
At Passage Point, we decided to go ashore for lunch as the tide was still not quite turning. It was a beautiful, warm, sunny day, and we didn't have to travel a big distance. In fact, on our Christmas trips, we usually try to avoid long days. This gives plenty of time for exploring, walking, or just relaxing. After lunch, we climbed the point to see Laurie playing in the strong currents in Sea Lion Narrows. It wasn't long before we joined in the fun.
Look at this whirlpool here.
This is an incredible place. You can practice your cut-ins and outs in the sea kayaks, in the sea. By putting up our sails, we could just make headway against the current. The setting is magnificent, with Mount Kerford towering over the narrows. Later we sailed across Kent Bay to Nautilus Cove. Laurie had made smoke so that we knew where he had landed. This is another historic site. In fact, when planning the trip, I had deliberately included this particular site as I had read so much about the earliest Tasmanian whaling station that was set up here in the 1790s. While clearing a tent site, I came across quite a collection of artefacts, including pottery and a clay pipe stem. This would have been quite a busy, boisterous place 200 years ago. That night, Laurie decided he would go back to Preservation Island through Armstrong Channel, as he had left the gas turned on in the shack and it was worrying him. Next morning, Mick, Grant and I, however, enjoyed a sleep-in before packing and paddling up to Sloping Point. From here we could easily make use of the westerly winds to sail across to Clark Island and then on down to Moriarty Point where we would camp. We made a quick crossing to Seal Point, thanks to the freshening winds. Poor Laurie, on the other hand, was slogging into them on his way to Preservation Island. The coastline of Clark Island was zipping past at a good rate of knots as we came across fishing boats near Black Point. Shortly afterwards, we landed for lunch behind a rocky point about 5 kilometres from Moriarty Point. Thank you. We were eager to see what the dreaded Moriarty Point looked like. Tomorrow we would have to negotiate the treacherous tidal rips and standing waves that seemed to be a permanent feature of this location. After lunch, we quickly covered the remaining distance to our campsite at the point.
No, you're missing the point.
This campsite is a little way in behind the beach, but is once again very sheltered. It was up at 5 o'clock next morning. We wanted to get the 3 hours of the incoming tide, so we would be taken up towards Cape Portland, then 3 hours of outgoing tides to bring us back to Little Musselrow Bay. Rounding the dreaded Moriarty Point was a complete anticlimax. There were no tidal rips or standing waves this time. Certainly the currents were strong, but the sea was quite calm as we drifted out into Banks Strait and home. Out off to the south, we could make out Swan Island. It quickly faded from view as the current swept us along towards Cape Portland. We could still see the peaks of Strzelecki behind us as we approached the Tasmanian coast. We assumed that Laurie would be there as usual to welcome us, as he had done all throughout the trip. But there was no sign of his kayak as we headed for the boat ramp. After Mick arrived, we discussed Laurie's probable location. As we emptied our kayaks of water and gear, Laurie paddled into view. He had left Preservation Island sometime after us and made good time across the strait. It had been an excellent trip with plenty of sailing and interesting campsites. The extra bonus of being able to land on the Farsund was icing on the cake.